Hello, I'm Jack Rickard. This is Electric Vehicle Television. I'd like to introduce this Friday, June 5th, 2015, Mr. Bob Wilson from San Jose, California. Is that how you pronounce that?
Exactly.
Welcome, Bob. Mr. Wilson wants to come be Brian Noto, and that's a full-time job even for Brian. And so he's kind of gone, and you want to come play EVTV?
Yes, I kind of consider myself the EV wannabe, and so now I'm going to be the EV gonna be.
And Bob literally packed up in his car, and you're actually from San Jose.
I'm from San Jose, California. Yes, sir.
And so he traveled all the way to the United States from California to come out here in the heartland and be among us provincials to play EVTV. Tell me a little bit about that, Bob. Why would that strike you as a thing to do?
Yeah, you know, I have yet to figure that out. But honestly, it's nice out here. People are nice. I'm actually enjoying myself and the countryside. And the drive out was wonderful with my girlfriend, Rhonda Jean. Hi, baby. I love you. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just this whole EV thing and watching EVTV for the last few years has been gradually pulling me. I've been wanting to do my own build. And like most of my projects, they're underfunded. And so I thought, mm-hmm. why not come and leverage your expertise and abilities and help you run this show.
So, Bob, you're going to be partying like a rock star because almost all my builds aren't working right now.
We've got work to do.
We've got stuff scattered all over the shop. The ones that we've done before aren't running. EVs being maintenance-free, of course.
Yeah.
And
who knew?
And the ones we're trying to do, we're not doing, because I've gone off on a new career in Candom, and you're showing up as both timely, and if you want to work on EVs, I think you've found nirvana.
Be drinking out of the fire hose
here
for a little while.
Out of the fire hose. because we've got it going on, and some little niggling something. Wrong with almost every piece of rolling stock on the lot. Let's see, Mark and Byron felt sorry for me and came down and fixed the van. Now, interestingly, I mentioned to in the hack team discussion, we have a little mailing list thing, that I had found another van at a Ford dealer. And they had like $50,000 in it, and it was 2 years old. They never sold it, and now it has a dead battery.
And I
offered them $5,000 for it, and they're considering it. And Byron said, well, is it this one at this dealership? I said, no, it isn't. He says, good, I'm grabbing it. And he bought one for $5,000.
Oh, he got it for $5,000.
He's already got it fixed in
good.
A week.
Good, good.
And is driving it around. It was the heater. Had somehow made it where it couldn't pre-charge, and so it never could come on, and he's already got it fixed.
And he did make note in the episode when they came to fix yours how much he liked it.
Yes, he did. And so, well, now you've got one.
Yeah, and having driven it myself, I got to say, I like it. It's got some good pep, and it's...
Now you've been in it. You see what the deal is.
I've been bitten.
It was an excellent little vehicle. I would say the Azure build has not got much to recommend it since they're always breaking, and none of the Ford dealers know how to use it. So in a world where we're fighting for the right to repair, and it should be left to the OEMs because they're the authorities, they're coming here to get parts and advice on how to fix their Azure Dynamics.
Right.
And the problem is, I don't know a whole lot about them. We've used the motor and the inverter for our own purposes, but the actual vehicle, I don't know. Mm. I haven't had to do much to it, and when it did break, Byron came and fixed it.
Yep.
So that's kind of a bizarre thing. We'll talk about this more, but this week we had four of our hack team members buy EVs.
Yeah, kind of interesting,
OEM huh? EVs. It really struck me, and I made a, there's a big write-up on the blog. We'll try to talk about it a little bit in this show at some point. Let's try to get this off and going. So welcome.
Thank you.
Hope you know, lives up to your expectations. Unfortunately, reality rarely does. and so it would be a miracle, but Bob was telling me about all the cars out there in California that were electric, and I said, well, you understand, I own half of them in the state of Missouri.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I'm used to seeing at least half a dozen Teslas a day. You know, and that many Leafs as well. So,
well, we have one here in town, but it's on the other side of the wall right now.
Right. Yeah. So I'm right at home. I still see one every day.
You still see one every day. There you go. It's a different world from California, so I'm somewhat concerned. But yeah, the people here are. It's a very different thing. You're not so distant. It's not like a transit community of people coming to work and then moving on. So. People have been here, been friends for 50 years.
Right, right.
I go to dinner with guys I went to first grade with. And so it's just a different world.
Yep.
But it's easy to make friends because everybody's not going 800 miles an hour with their hair on fire like they are in Denver or
exactly.
Like Houston or something like that. You know?
Exactly.
It's a little more laid back. Just the amount of time you spend in a car, I've said the Cape's a perfect venue for electric vehicles. All that commuting takes time out of your day. There's a good percentage of the population spending 3 hours a day in a car.
Tragic.
When you add all that up, that's 11 work weeks a year.
Yeah.
That we just don't do here. I mean, it's 7 minutes to anywhere in Cape Girardeau.
Right.
In traffic. So we just don't do that, and you wind up with at least a couple of hours a day that people in those large metropolitan areas don't have, and it's cumulative. It eats away your life.
Exactly.
We just don't do that, and so we can sleep an hour later and stay up an hour later or whatever we want to do.
Sure.
Because every day we get 2 hours they don't get. It's like, you know, waking up every day with a two-hour bump from daylight savings time.
Which, actually, I'm still adjusting to. It's kind of funny, the time difference and such. But
well, if you're going to play Brian, you got to bring news on Fridays. What do you got?
Okay. Well, and, of course, we start with Tesla, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
So Tesla's stock price has been climbing. It's closed at just under $250 today.
Uh-huh.
You know, they've actually been down. The low was March 27th at 185, and it says things were starting to take off in April.
Uh-huh. Well, that's a 25-30% bump in a few months.
Yeah, exactly, 25%. And so this article is from the Business Insider that I grabbed here, and they're asking, so what's fueling this rally?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's a few things. One is the new battery business being a part of it. Their continued confidence that they're going to be able to deliver the Model X on time.
Mm-hmm.
They're making progress, although what I understand is they got beat up in Texas pretty good, but they're making progress in their dealer network and being allowed to sell cars directly to consumers in more states. And then the construction of the $5 billion Gigafactory is you know, a plus. And then now there's all these used Teslas that are coming off of lease that are, you know, creating a whole new used car market. So there's quite a positive note for Tesla.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure whether that's positive and what if it's negative. The used cars has got me a little concerned. They have come out with a certified pre-owned program.
Right.
If you recall, a few weeks ago, we had a video from one of our viewers of Highlands Park, Illinois, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Like an acre of Teslas that had all been turned in on the new what do they call it, the D
for
model?
The D, yeah.
That is four-wheel drive. And so there's a bunch of Tesla trade-ins. The lowest price I saw was $55,000.
Right.
And the reason I remember that is that the original price that Elon Musk and Tesla said, now the Roadster was supposed to be 109, and then it got to be about 125 new. But it was all going to be better with the Tesla Model S, which would be $55,000.
Right.
Care to guess how many Teslas they sold at $55,000?
Roughly zero.
Roughly zero, plus or minus zero.
Yeah.
And so that was, it never happened. It never even got close. I paid $107 for mine. With the D, you're at about $120.
Yeah, exactly.
Uh-huh. So that's over twice the $55.
Yeah.
But now you can get one used for $55. We'll see how this plays out.
Yeah, does that open the market, you know?
Man, it's got me. And that was part of what I went off about in the blog this week. Chevrolet has 6,000 2015 volts on dealer lots unsold. Mm. And both Chevrolet and Nissan have each sold about 75,000 cars, or at least 75,000 cars.
Right, right.
And a lot of them on very sweetheart leases. And this spring, they're starting to get those in. And so if 3 years ago they leased, they sold 25,000, let's say half of them were leases, that's about 10 or 12,000 cars.
Mm-hmm.
And that will continue every month to come off for at least the next 3 years.
Right.
And so there's all these cars. Then in 2016, Chevrolet is going to introduce the new Volt, which, and the Volt we count as an electric car mostly because the owners do.
Right.
But they have an electric car with a 35-mile range. You can't really do this with a plug-in Prius or something because it's 5 or 6 miles. But with a national average of 39.4 miles a day, you can take a Volt and pretend like it's an electric car. Now you're getting about the range we used to with the lead-acid batteries.
Yeah, right.
But they're driving an electric car, and they think it is one. And so it's not my place to correct them. If they think it's one, we think it's one. And the way they're driving it is the determining factor here. And they're driving it as an electric car. They don't run it with the fuel, but very rarely.
Yeah.
There's
that peace of mind, I suppose, that, they're generally
it gives
just
them peace of mind. They can drive off to another city, but they take great pride in how little of that they do.
Yeah, as we discussed.
And, well, now we have to do it on camera. And so, but they're going to bump that to 60 in September. And you had an item on Nissan and the Leaf doing a similar improvement. Where are they going with
that? That's correct. Well, they've coming out with a 30 kilowatt battery, kilowatt hour battery, that is replacing their 24 kilowatt hour battery. So they're going to be able to up their mileage to around 100.
100?
Yeah.
Well, that's been a big criticism of the Leaf. So who wants an old Leaf when there's a one that'll do 100 miles?
Evidently,
in a couple of months. My hack team just went crazy this week, and as I said, Byron got an Azure Dynamics. Christopher Brand had a Leaf that he had leased for like $99 a month.
Right.
And he had 39 months in it. That's $3,900 plus whatever he put down on it.
Yeah.
And they offered him the car for $11,500. I mean, he was really going to give it back to him and had every intention of doing it.
Right, right.
But $11,500.
For a car that only he has driven.
And he knows about.
Yeah, yeah.
He knows where all the bodies are buried on it, whether it's any good or not.
Right, right.
Well, so he no sooner got that than Damien got one in Ireland, and Mark Weisheimer actually came here to Missouri and picked one up, and he got an upscale one, leather and sunroof and the whole thing for his wife, 13.5.
Yeah.
Very low miles, like 20.
20 miles?
20,000.
Okay.
But his wife commutes 4 miles.
That ought to last.
It'll last in 2040. So they've gone crazy. There's a guy in Houston, a dealer, a Nissan dealer in Houston, who had 4 of them on eBay, and they all looked, they were glowing in the dark. Not a scratch on them.
Mm-hmm.
25 to 35 thousand. Nice colors. The SL version, the upscale version, with the fast charge. $10,488.
Pretty much no brainer.
Take one, take them all. He didn't
care.
So this is a car that 3 years ago was $38,000. Here's the problem. This is the death of the electric car.
That's right.
This is going to go bad pretty quickly. And it has to do with our deep tribal knowledge of batteries. And I don't mean that as our viewers and their electric car. I mean people in general and batteries in general. Flashlights. Cell phones.
Right. We all know batteries die.
We all know batteries die.
Yeah.
And so if electric car is cool when it's new and has new batteries, that still doesn't mean it's cool to have a used one with used batteries. Now, the deep inside tribal knowledge is actually these batteries are a lot better than even I thought they would be. The Nissan Leaf batteries, we now have a little bit of experience with in these Better Place packs we were selling.
Right.
And reports from guys all over the country and the world that have them. They don't have any problems with them. They've ripped the BMS that's supposed to take care of it off of them. And they're just running them bare. And they just go and go and go.
Right.
And apparently you can't hurt them. And there's some indications from some high mileage Leaf guys that these batteries could go 150,000 to 200,000 miles.
Stay within those ranges.
You know. But that's not the public perception. Here's an electric car coming off lease. It's 3 years old and it has used batteries. If I buy this car and the batteries aren't any good, I'm going to be out batteries, and everybody knows they're expensive this time.
Yeah.
I don't know what that is, but they're expensive. And so this goes to depreciation. And what we're seeing already, a fact, not a theory.
Which is why the hack team got such great deals.
Why the hack team went spasmo on it, is that you can buy a car for 25% of its original sticker price.
A three-year-old car.
3 years old.
Yeah, right.
With 35,000 miles on it. And as Mark said, I've bought cars that weren't nearly that good for more money to give to my kids knowing they were going to tear them up and wreck them.
Right.
at $10,000, $12,000, this doesn't. Well, he grabbed one at 13.5. So that's the most sincere
fully loaded
vote is when you write the check.
Yeah.
And so now here we're going to go into the fall. New models. A lot of the dealers never did like these cars. They don't bring in the maintenance money that the other ones do. They're not maintenance free, but they don't use a lot of filters and belts and
oil
stuff that they're used to getting the regular cash flow from. And it's kind of implied that if you let the dealer do all that, then they'll take care of you if there's any serious warranty work. And so they make a ton on that stuff. And it doesn't work out on the electrics. They don't like selling them. They don't like servicing them. And in most cases, never did develop any in-house expertise in servicing them.
That's right.
So it's worse than just the batteries. You got a three-year-old car coming off warranty, except for the battery, which is still gets 8 years and 100,000 miles. But how are you going to get this thing worked on at all? And so the depreciation on the cars is a horror. Now, how long is it going to take for the word to get out that you buy an electric car and 3 years later it's worth 25% what you paid?
Yeah, that makes it hard to sell the new cars.
Buy an internal combustion car, 3 years later it's worth two-thirds.
Right.
You know, I mean, you take a hit, but not like this. It's going to kill. It will. I think it'll actually kill electric car sales. And I think the dealers for Nissan and GM, and understand they're not Tesla dealers that have to do what Elon tells them. These are independent businesses. They don't have to take these cars.
That's right.
I mean, yeah. They can't make them. There's a Nissan dealer here in town who has never had a Leaf on his lot, never sold one, doesn't have a fast charger, and doesn't want anything to do with them. And Nissan.
And you can't make me.
And Nissan can't make him.
Yeah.
Now, if they have a dealer revolt in the autumn because unsold 2015 stock and stuff raining on them from coming off lease. Chevrolet, Volt, Nissan, Leaf are two of the companies that can't do anything about that. They can't do a thing other than mark them down more. And so I've been watching technology my adult life. That's kind of what I do and try to predict where it's going. And I, what happens is you have alternate waves of near hysterical excitement and enthusiasm followed by despair and disappointment that you've been had, that it didn't pan out, that it wasn't what it was hyped to be.
Wasn't, yep, yep.
And a year later, it's back on the ascendant, if it's real. I mean, we went through this with the internet from the beginning. It was a fait accompli in 1987. And then it kind of went away. And then it came back in 89.
Yeah.
And then it kind of went away. But each time we'd get a little stronger, a little more people who were knowledgeable and did have tribal knowledge of it and extended the frame. And so I would predict that by the end of this year, they will be discussing the death of the electric car, and OEMs will be bailing on their model plans and stuff left and right. It'll be a bloodbath for them and for EVs in general, except that for us, it's going to be raining cars and parts, and I would expect to pick up a gorgeous Nissan Leaf for $7,500 by the end of the year, and a gorgeous Volt, a low miles, for under 10.
Yeah.
And any part I wanted to own. And I frankly, I think this is going to extend to Tesla.
Quite possibly. It's just the same reason you just
don't
said,
don't you
right?
want a new Model X?
Well, right, there's that. And then, but the fact
if
that
I gave you a choice between an S and an X right now, which would it be?
I would obviously take either one, but just the fact that
if you get to pick between them, which would it be?
Well, I guess the X is pretty
awesome. Well, I guess the X with the Falcon doors.
Yeah, the Falcon doors.
It carries more
stuff. But
they still
have the same depreciation problem, you know?
What happens to all the S's?
Yeah.
If there's not new people hankering to have an electric car and words out that depreciation is a problem, I will wish that I had taken him up on the lease and his guarantee of repurchase.
Trade-in value.
Yeah, trade-in value.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think that actually applies to me because I bought mine.
He's going to hang you out there, huh?
Yeah.
Even though you're out all the cash, too.
And he's already got literally hundreds of them and has established a certified pre-owned to deal with that. But it's shaping up to be a bloodbath from the very top at Tesla to the very bottom at IMEV. How many IMEVs did they sell this month?
I think a whole 18.
Well, that could be cut in half.
Uh-oh.
And so what were the EV sales for May? You got some
figures. What are they going to do the rest of the month there? Yeah, so Tesla, well, actually, so the news of the sales for May is that it's been a great month. Everything is up 27%. That's because
from April.
Yeah, from April, right. And it's been a relatively dismal, you know, previous few months. At any rate, the Tesla sold 2,400 units in May, which is up from 1,700 in April.
Mm-hmm.
The Leaf has sold 2,104, which is up from 1,553. That's a 35% increase.
Mm-hmm.
The BMW i3, that's a really cool little car, and it they sold 818 of them,
mm-hmm.
and that's actually a 100% increase over April, mm-hmm. which where they sold over only 400. The Volt, remarkably, has sold 1,618 the month of May, which is up from 905 the previous month.
Mm-hmm.
The Fiat 500e estimated sales of 420. Which is down from the previous month. The Spark EV, wow, that took a hit. That down from 920 to 283.
The 920 was exceptional.
Yeah.
$99
absolutely,
lease.
$99 absolutely.
Lease in April.
If you take out April, it's up over the rest of the months. The e-Golf, which I actually like, sold 410 units. The Mercedes B-Class sold 278 units.
Mm-hmm.
The Ford Focus Electric is right at 165. The BMW i8 sold 117 units. The Smart, 102. The Cadillac ELR, 116. The Porsche Cayenne SE, 105. And the Kia Soul, which is also kind of a cute little EV.
Mm-hmm.
Sold 108 cars,
mm-hmm.
and I think you had mentioned in a previous episode how that's probably a compliance car, but
You get it down into that. I've got a little bit different take on all this. Part of the disconnect is that we do battery electric vehicles. Most of the people who put together these numbers do green cars.
Yeah,
and we get this from Autoblog Green. Inside EVs is really who's doing the best counts, and then Green Car News or something. We're a little more specialized. I look at this. Volt has sold 4,397 for the year,
mm-hmm.
and has 6,000 out on the lots. They're not in production at the moment. They're retooling for the 2016. The Leaf, it's a great month for the year. They've sold 742 for the year, but that's down 33% from May of the previous year.
Yeah.
And that they don't really kind of bring all that out. Even though it's an increase in May from April, May, June, July, August are big months for electric cars for some reason. And so they'll do more then than even toward the end of the year. I don't know why. It's not a normal car pattern. That said, so it's kind of doom and gloom in a way in the face of falling fuel prices, but not entirely, all things being relative. The hybrid cars, the Toyota Prius, it's owned it for years, 20 years, 15 years.
Yeah.
They're getting clobbered. They're down 100 and 150 and 125, depending on the
model.
I
didn't mention it, but they have only sold 727 this last month.
Well, they used to sell 2,000, 3,000 a month.
Right.
And so I think we've got a smaller universe because of the falling price of gas, and the people that are still interested in green cars are more interested in electric cars
than
they were, and that's some movement from what had been the more popular hybrids to the pure electrics.
Yep.
I think that's what's going on. But I think as the dawning realization of this depreciation issue is a big deal. My dad, maybe I'm oversensitive to it. Maybe other people don't care about depreciation. My father was like from, an early age, he taught me there's only one way to buy a car.
Yeah.
2 years old and 10,000 miles.
Because the minute you drive it off, you lose thousands of dollars.
Cut out that 2 years of depreciation and still have a low mileage car, not a salesman's car or something. 10,000 miles in 2 years is low.
That's low
mileage. Yeah. So he would actually shop hard for a car with 2 years, two model years on it, and 10,000 miles. And he taught me that. And I mean, it's just ingrained. When I was growing up, I thought they only made...
Two-year-old cars?
I thought they only made new cars for, as I best recall it, morons that shouldn't be allowed to pull a little red wagon down the road, I think is how he put it. And so I thought they just made new cars for stupid people. And that bright people like us would buy them 2 years old, 10,000 miles. Same with tires. You didn't buy four tires. You bought two tires. You put them on the front.
Yep.
And you put the two on the front and put them on the back. And you never had to buy four tires because every time you had the tires going bad,
you'd rotate them out.
You'd get two.
Yeah.
And that's just, there were just certain ways you did things with cars. And that was to avoid being a stupid person, which I didn't want
to
be.
Nobody wants to be that guy.
Not around that.
Yeah.
No, you don't want to be that. And so I'm kind of keyed to the depreciation issue, but this looks like a depreciation bloodbath. And if that breaks out into the public consciousness, that if you buy an electric car, it's twice as bad on depreciation as an internal combustion car, I think it has the potential to kill the market.
It hurts the industry for sure.
It's sure going to be a setback. And already you have other issues. John Griswell of Austin, Texas, over the weekend had a feral kitten take up residence in the motor compartment of his Tesla Model S. It was purring like a kitten. Let's take a look.
It's not gonna fall, is it?
I'll make it where it doesn't. I'll leave these in.
Has it got all its claws?
I have no idea, my friend. It's a feral cat.
Oh, it's not yours.
It's a kitten. Yeah, it's a feral kitten that I picked up somewhere on Friday, I think.
Oh, okay. So it doesn't even belong to you. It's just just a stray.
Yeah.
He's moving. He's on the move. I know. That's what I'm expecting.
At least you got gloves.
Oh, he is going to fall a little. I'm trying not to.
He's a cat. He'll be all right.
They do fall in the
feet. I can try and get him.
Okay. Here goes the weight. All right, so how this shield folds down, and then it's just going to be one piece. So it's probably like this whole thing.
See him.
Yeah.
Where is he?
Aw, come here, buddy. He's tiny.
Oh, he is a little one. Look at that.
That is crazy.
Aww.
He's alive. I know.
He's mad, too.
Hey, buddy. All right, just chill. Not in the car anymore. That's crazy.
Now, you had something about CHAdeMO.
I do. We've got the Ford, I got UQM, and CHAdeMO.
Okay. Let's do that.
Preference, CHAdeMO.
Yeah, CHAdeMO, whatever you want to call it. All right, let's do them.
Okay. In other news, this spring the U.S. exceeded 1,200 CHAdeMO charge stations, 1,238 to be exact. The number of CHAdeMO DC quick chargers installed today is 8,549.
Worldwide.
Worldwide.
Okay.
And guess who has the most?
Nippon?
Japan has over two-thirds of them at 5,418. So that leaves the rest to Europe and it says 55 others in other countries. So Europe has 1,838. We have 1,238. And Japan has the rest basically at 5,418.
We think CHAdeMO is the ultimate winner. And we're working hard on a kit for DIY guys, but we took one on the chin this week. Let's go send this to Damien Maguire to explain why.
All right, sports fans. Let's see if the damn thing will start. To your butts. Oh yeah. Oh, that power steering pump sounds really cool spinning up. Got power steering, yeah. Absolutely perfect power steering, one finger. We got 245s on the front of this thing. Brakes. Yeah. We got power brakes. And let's give her some gas. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Okay, I think this baby's ready to start rolling, folks. Screw it, let's fire it up again. Oh, this is not gonna get old. Sounds like a friggin' gas turbine. Uh-oh. Jeez. What's this? Ooh. Oh, wow. Ooh. Wow. Oh, look at this. Wow. Germans think of everything. More gas. Goes up that window actually.
Got to get that tackle working. A little bit of dividing down the spare encoder on the motor for that. Putting out 64 pulses per rev, so we need to divide that down to, I think, 4 pulses per rev for the V8 tack. So get the temperature gauge working, fuel gauge, everything else. But she's ready to roll, folks. She is ready to roll. Welcome to our next CHAdeMO update. So, I thought I would just give you guys a quick update on where we are with the CHAdeMO fast charging and the whole JLD 505 setup. So, over the past months now, I've been pretty much driving around to the fast charging stations with the Landia E-Yacht, and we've been having some difficulties. So just to recap, I have one fast charging station that's about 4 miles away from where I live, and it's manufactured by an Italian company called AeroVironment. And this charger is perfect. It just, it was the first charger that we got working with the JLD 505. And pretty much since then, it's been absolutely rock solid charger. It advertises a maximum on the CAN bus of 500 volts and 125 amps, and it charges that 125 amps into the land yacht's battery absolutely perfectly. The thing doesn't even break as sweat, because you think about it, 125 amps at 177 volts probably isn't even 25 kilowatts, so it's probably really only running at about 50% of its design power. Now, once we had that charger working, we had the software kind of even the all the kind of quirks and the bugs reasonably ironed out of it. We obviously then I started going to some of the different manufacturers' chargers, and immediately we hit problems whereby the car just wouldn't charge, or it would start charging and then shut down. It would charge for various periods of time. It would charge at various power settings, but never the full power. And we've spent quite a bit of time. I've been logging data, sending it back to Colin and Jack. We've been just trying to work out what's been going on. Now, I have a theory, and that's about all it is. It's a bit of a theory here. The resting voltage in the land yacht when you, you know, when you've driven the car a bit and you've pulled up to a charging point, it's usually around 165 volts, and we charge to 177 volts, which is 3.55 volts per cell. Now, the aero environment charger here locally has no problem doing that. I think, and I'm just theorizing this based on a little bit of some data that indicates it, but I believe that some of the other manufacturers' chargers that we have visited and tried to charge the car on, I don't think that they can charge the full CHAdeMO voltage range. The CHAdeMO specification states that a charger has to be able to charge up to 125 amps from 50 to 500 volts DC. Now, 50 to 500 volts is a very wide swing. And I think that some of the manufacturers looked at the voltage ranges that they would be charging. So, for example, a Nissan Leaf, what other cars do we, Mitsubishi, IMEV, all these OEM cars, which will generally have battery packs in the 300 to 400 volts DC range. And I think that they basically came along, and when they were designing the power electronics in these chargers, basically decided that they would charge those voltage ranges and not the full 50 to 500 volts swing. Now, that leads me to the question, well, why have they passed CHAdeMO certification then? Because in my view, to be a CHAdeMO certified DC fast charger, you would have to be able to charge from 50 to 500 volts at 125 amps. But certain data that I've collected on one particular brand of charger, I can at best get 60 amps out of it, even though it advertises 120 amps available. And even at that, there seems to be a very high level of instability in its current delivery. So when we request 60 amps, the current can vary by plus or minus 10 amps. And I believe that this may well be down to the fact that the converter is on the very limit of its ability to maintain voltage and current regulation. The aero environment charger is a much older design and is quite a large, kind of an industrialized brick of a charger. I'll try and get a picture up here for you. And but it is perfectly stable. I kind of suspect that I could roll up a 48 volt golf trolley, plug the thing in, and it would charge it at 125 amps for me. But it's looking like, and I have no real definitive proof on this, but it looks to me like, from some of the data, from some of the CAN messages, and from some of the current instabilities that I've observed, I think that some of these more modern chargers, let's say, do not have the ability to swing the full CHAdeMO voltage range. Now, that leads us to the question, well, what voltage range can they actually operate on? And I suppose it's unfortunate in one sense that the land yacht is a, you know, it's 50 cell pack, it's nominally 160 volts, it's a DC system, but that car has just been fantastic. I've been driving it nearly 18 months now, and it's my daily driver. I put 400 miles a week on it minimum, and to have the ability to DC fast charge would have been really fantastic. To get it up over 200 volts, I probably need to put something in the region of 15 more cells into the car. But sadly, at the minute, I don't have the resources to do that with all the projects that I have going on. So what are we going to do? What's the next stage here? Well, some of you may be aware from my previous videos, I'm building a BMW E31 8 Series, and that's an AC drive using the EVTV Siemens three-phase AC motor, along with the inverter that I spent 6 months putting together. Probably my do it the hard way attitude showing itself again. So that car is now getting very near the point that we're going to be able to move it. So we're going to be fitting CHAdeMO again with the JLD 505 and the CHAdeMO socket contactors, all of that supporting hardware to that car with our Nissan Leaf, donor vehicle secured for that, and that car will have the pack from the Leaf and the Renault Fluence pack that I got from EVTV about a year or so ago. That's going to yield us 400 volts at, I suppose, something approaching 45 kilowatt hours. So we will be right in the middle of the OEM voltage range then, and it will be very interesting to go back to some of these chargers with the exact same setup, the exact same software in the JLD 505, and plug the car in and see if it likes 400 volts. I rather suspect that we will find all of the chargers work perfectly at 400 volts. I'm a bit hacked off with that, if that proves to be the case. It may or may not be. It could be something completely different going on, but I just have a gut feeling based upon a little bit of supporting evidence and probably a lot of talking and typing myself smart here, but the only real way to prove this will be to roll the Panzer in, plug in, press the button. So that's what we're going to do, folks. So stay with us. We'll keep you all posted.
And so Damien spins up the motor, but also explains to us a little bit. Apparently, not all of the EVSE manufacturers precisely followed the spec.
Not all created equal.
Right. The specification is supposed to be for 50 volts to 500 volts. But on their behalf, what is there that charges on CHAdeMO? The Leaf, the IMEV.
That's about it, huh?
A couple of European cars, maybe the Renault or something. But, I mean, nothing here. Literally nothing. The Kia Soul is going to.
Okay.
Kia Soul. But, I mean, there aren't any of them out there. And all the rest, the Golf and BMW i3, the Volt doesn't do fast charge at all. We're actually going to make our kit where they can. I think they're going to want to. It's only General Motors that thinks they won't. So when you look at all those cars, how many of them are below 300 volts ever? Well, there's some issues in power switching electronics. If you start from 240 volts and rectify it, you're at about 310 to 330. And there's just some issues with inductors and component costs and so forth. And what Damien was basically finding, he had one charge station that actually, I believe, he put into a maintenance mode where they have to come repair it.
Yeah. One or two.
His car is 177 volts, and he got it to give him, he asked for 70 amps. And we had the logs, and this thing is hunting around between 70 and 85 amps, and it can't really lock on. And so because of his low voltage, it's developing some stability problems trying to maintain that 70 amps of current at that voltage. And some of the others just shut down on him, and we can't figure out why. And there's no fault. There is a fault for incompatible battery, which they should be triggering, but that admits that they don't do the spec, because the spec is 50 to 500 volts. And so I think we've got more than one EVSE manufacturer that have kind of shaved the spec a little bit and fudged it. And I can see why. What a car is going to show up at even below 300, much less 200, or much less 50.
Yeah.
There are a couple of motorcycle guys out there with the Brammos, T-Zeros, and so forth, that have kind of noted that, hey, this isn't working.
They use CHAdeMO as well?
Some of them are trying to.
Okay.
And they can't charge their bikes because they don't do high enough voltage for the CHAdeMO stations. Mm-hmm. And so we've uncovered kind of a dirty little secret of CHAdeMO. How upset am I over this? Well, it's a little bit of a time setback because Damien is our test guy and he's got a 177-volt car. That's why when we get your Panzer done, it'll be a 330-volt car, 370 actually.
Yeah.
And so then we're back in the game and can prove this all out. Going forward, I got to tell you guys, there's nothing wrong with them, but I don't see us doing a whole lot with cars that are under 300 volts. I'm kind of like the EVSE guys.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of who cares? We're doing all AC systems.
We like to sell batteries 100 at a time.
We get to sell batteries 100 at a time. We get to sell smaller batteries at 100 at a time. It doesn't really make us any difference. It's more connections for us. And that's kind of an issue. This is our new Nordlock XP washer. I don't know if you can see it. They're a little more expensive. See, I include all that hardware for free with our batteries.
Right, straps.
I'm constantly getting beat up that our batteries are too expensive. Everybody else's is cheaper. There was a guy called this week, and he said, do you have any CA40s? I said, yeah, I think I've got 20 or 30 of them sitting here. He says, well, I need 22. Can you do that? Let me check. I come back, and I said, yeah, we've got that. Like I say, we got about 30 of them. He says, I'd like to buy them. Now, you're not going to, like, call Pomona and then call me back and tell me you don't have them. I said, no, I've got them in the back room. He said, well, you're the fifth guy I've called. And everybody takes the order, and then they call me back later and say they talked to Pomona and there aren't really any of them there because they're out of stock.
Hmm. I just told you.
So I called Pomona, and they told me that the only person that would have that kind of number would be Jack Rickard at EVTV. Because we do stock a few batteries. Now, you know, I'm dropping shipping more than I used to, but it's simply because we got more different kinds of batteries now.
Yeah.
Used to, I had two basic batteries that everybody right. bought, and we've got a few
chocolate
more. But we stock everything. We've got 180s and 100s and 72s, and I've got the only Cam 80s in the world, actually. And so forth, 60s. But for 22 of them, I can fill that. But he really couldn't believe it. Now, here's the part I picked up on. He called four other people before me.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm not going to play. If you're stupid, you should go somewhere else. Yes, we're more expensive. You get more stuff.
Think of total cost of ownership.
In doing 100 cells instead of 20, here's how I get beat.
Yeah.
We include for free the Nordlock washers, two of them per cell, the strap, and the bolt. And I've got all this worked out. I've done it over years. This is a little upgrade. It's not a big thing, but it's another dime a washer for me.
Sure.
They're called XPs. It's the same zinc-coated Nordlock washer we've been including with the batteries, but now it has a little conical compression. It's a little domed when you screw it down. Not only does it wedge lock, but it also flattens and has this conical thing. Why is that important? We use really soft copper straps. And so the copper gives a little bit after you tighten it down. Well, with that conical spring in it.
Keeps tension.
It keeps tension on it. And so they simply work better than the previous ones. And so we did this 2 months ago, and I never mentioned it to anybody, but they are more expensive. The batteries we sell come with all the stuff. And we put a sanding block in there and a little piece of nylon rope with two terminals so you can lift one out of the center. And a pair of gloves. I don't wear gloves dealing with batteries, but a lot of guys like to. And so, no, I get people and we send them the batteries, and they say, what's all this stuff for? Just put it in a corner in a box. It'll come to you as you stick with the battery. We already know.
Of course you do.
We know what it's for, and you will too. And I don't have to explain it. It'll come to you in the night. Yeah. It'd be nice to have
3 o'clock
some way
in the morning revelation.
To pull one of these batteries out without the others. Don't take a coat hanger and hang it on the two terminal bolts. That's not what you want to do. Don't ask me how I know these things. Nylon rope is non-conductive if you only had some. Wait a minute. There's some in the box. Oh, with two terminals on it. That's
what do
cute.
You know? Hey, look, it happens to fit.
It happens to fit. So that's what's going on there. I don't know how we got off on all this, but the higher voltages, I'm just out more hardware, and I don't get anything for it because we include it.
Yeah.
But I kind of like the littler cells. They're more granular. It's easier to work them around the car than the bigger ones.
Sure, sure.
So that works out pretty good.
The challenge of securing bolts has been around for as long as there has been a need to bolt things together. Along the way, plenty of ideas evolved to make sure parts held together, no matter how high or how big, or how extreme our inventions got. And we've seen some interesting innovations. 30 years ago, when Nordlock launched what's proven to be the world's most secure washer, the possibilities expanded for what we could design and accomplish. Now, just imagine, we've made it twice as good. Get ready for a new evolution in bolt security. Nuts and bolts are an unbeatable combination, offering great holding power while still being easy to dismantle. The downside with bolts is they can loosen unintentionally. Critical fasteners that have not been properly secured can have catastrophic consequences in terms of safety, as well as costly downtime. Loosening problems get more and more challenging due to new technologies and market demands, from thick surface coatings for corrosion protection to advances in sandwich composite technology. And these are just two examples of many. Technically, bolts fail for two reasons: spontaneous bolt loosening and slackening. Spontaneous bolt loosening occurs due to vibrations or dynamic loads. Any movement between the clamped parts jeopardizes the bolted joint. Let's see what happens to an unsecured bolt when exposed to vibration. we tighten to a clamp load of 20 kilonewtons. The bolt starts to loosen, and the clamp load drops significantly. The other reason bolts loosen is slackening. The development of new materials and techniques has made slackening a serious problem due to settlement and relaxation. Let's see what happens to an unsecured bolt in static conditions. When bolting materials together, the pressure will cause any irregularities on the surfaces to begin flattening immediately, with significant settlement happening within the first hours after tightening. This results in a loss of preload. Certain materials that are susceptible to settlement, such as soft metals, composites, and polymers, are becoming more common in application design. Solutions currently available on the market focus on only one of the two critical loosening factors, meaning none is successful in counteracting both factors at once. And so, designers are faced with the challenge of figuring out which factor, spontaneous bolt loosening or slackening, will have the biggest effect on the joint, and choosing a solution to handle that one problem. It is a difficult compromise to make, especially when both can cause application failure. This is no longer a problem. Now, you can count on one solution to meet all your bolt securing needs. Utilizing a unique multifunctional design, Nordlock X series washers offer the highest security against both spontaneous bolt loosening and slackening. You no longer have to compromise on bolt security for your critical joints. Nordlock X series is a unique solution in bolt securing. By combining Nordlock's unrivaled wedge effect to prevent the bolt from rotating loose, with an exceptional spring effect to compensate for loss of preload due to slackening, Nordlock X series washers give you total security for those situations in which there can be no compromise. Let's take a closer look at how it works. Upon tightening, the washers flatten and the serrations engage the contact surfaces. Since the cam angle alpha is greater than the thread pitch beta, the wedge locking effect will prevent any rotation of the fastener. Directly after tightening, the joint settles and the fastener sinks into the surface material. The washers immediately deflect and the elastic reserve counteracts slackening, thereby preventing loss of preload on the joint. These multiple functions continuously act on the bolted joint to maintain preload and prevent spontaneous bolt loosening, serving as an effective solution for vibration, dynamic loads, settlement, and relaxation. This means you can use one solution for all your bolt securing needs and decrease your inventory. Whenever you're not sure which loosening problem will have a bigger effect, or simply don't want to take any risks in your bolt design, Nordlock X series will keep you and your investment safe. Today, there are solutions available to handle mainly one of the reasons for bolt loosening, but none capable of securing both. Let's look at some examples. All bolted joints have a functional preload range in which the joint is safe. If the preload is too high, yielding occurs. If it is too low, there is separation or sliding between the parts. To see how different products function in various circumstances, we look at two phases: a static phase, when settlement happens, and a dynamic phase, when vibration is added and the fastener may rotate. We start with a bolt secured with a traditional split ring. The split ring counteracts settlement, but not vibration, so the bolt will likely rotate loose when exposed to vibration. The serrated spring washer is an attempt to counter both settlement and dynamic loads. It does a fair job countering settlement, but when also exposed to vibration, the bolt may rotate loose. Other products have the opposite problem. Adhesive is commonly used against vibration. However, in the static phase, the joint will lose its preload, and with vibration added, will risk loosening. The Nordlock original washer was never designed to counteract settlement, but until now, it has been the best solution to prevent the bolt from rotating loose. Now, Nordlock X Series washers give you the unique benefit of preventing loosening, regardless of whether the bolt is affected by settlement or vibration. Nordlock X Series counters each challenge in a unique, multifunctional way. It is the only product on the market that can secure bolts from both critical loosening factors at once. Serious problems start as soon as a bolted joint falls outside the functional preload range. Only Nordlock X Series keeps you within the optimal limits. That truly is bolt security without compromise. When you choose Nordlock X Series, you can rest assured your bolt system will stay secure. You also get the benefit of a professional partner. Our global team of experts works closely together with our customers to solve their toughest bolting challenges. With Nordlock, you also get quality in every detail. Our state-of-the-art products have been manufactured in northern Sweden since 1982, with a proven record of excellence. When you choose Nordlock X Series, you select the world's most effective bolt security, without compromise.
That's what's going on with the CHAdeMO kit. We may not be able to support under 200 volts on all chargers because the chargers won't do it. They're supposed to, but they don't.
Can't seem to find that proper amperage is what it really boils down to. Is that right?
For the power switching to do a buck when it really wants to do a boost, designed to do a boost, to do a buck down that low is gets into the edge of the pulse width modulation and the lower, you know, very narrower pulses, and you start having just stability problems in the circuit. You can't maintain a particular voltage or a particular current. And so now the aero environment that's closest to his home, for a couple of months now, we've been charging fine.
Yeah.
He just pulls in, plugs it in. 20 minutes, he's gone.
Which is a feather in the cap.
125
amp. An endorsement for the aero environment, right?
Right, I mean, right, it like, is.
They seem to do it right.
Yeah, except you don't get to shop for the EVSE. Whatever's there when you get there, that's what you use. And some of them have been shaving the spec on the concept that nobody's ever going to come along with a 177-volt car.
Yep.
Well, Damien did. And there you go. There you have it. And there it is. Let's go to Colin Kidder, our own man with the plan. We are doing some neat stuff with circuit boards and so forth. In fact, I've got finally got some samples in that are completely what I wanted. And completely what we designed and completely work.
Imagine that.
And that is for an EVTV Dewey. This is like an Arduino Dewey, but instead of having the two little fragile USB ports that break off, I've got one on the native port, which is on what we use. The native port is the port that's built into the chip. There's another port called a programming port with an external chip and stuff that's kind of a mess. It never was a very good idea, I don't think. There's a CAN controller built into the chip, but there's no CAN transceiver on it, so we put one of those.
Okay.
And unlike all previous Arduinos, there's no internal EEPROM. Everything we do with an Arduino, it is turned off, it's turned on many times, and we want to be able to set things in the program, configure it once, and then the next time it comes up, it should get that out of this permanent memory. And so we added an EEPROM chip. So this is my own little wish list for an Arduino Dewey. It's a single board Arduino that's 84 megahertz, 32-bit, ARM, you know, 3.
Bigger, better, faster, stronger.
Bigger, better, faster, stronger. But this one has a CAN port that works already built in and an EEPROM. And so we've got that. We've got another board that is our CAN Dewey kit that we sell, and it's got two CAN ports. And now I've got a new version of that coming. It's not here yet, but it's two ports plus a single wire CAN port. Now, what's that? That's what we use with the Eberspacher.
Yeah.
But why did I spend all the time on the heater and the Eberspacher and the single wire CAN and then put it on a board that already had two CAN ports? Guess what Tesla uses for communications with their superchargers?
The single wire.
It is. In fact, it looks remarkably like CHAdeMO. It pretty much is CHAdeMO.
Mm-hmm.
Has a couple of variations. It's got VIN numbers of the car.
VIN numbers, right.
And it's got a thing where it can fall back at any time and restart in a little more cogent fashion in the event that clouds pass the solar panels or somebody comes and plugs in next to you and it can't produce that much current now.
Mm.
It's a little fallback. But the communications is on the pilot pin, single wire CAN, at 33.33 kilobits. If you wanted to talk to your charger at home, that's a Tesla charger, or their supercharger on the road, it's going to be single wire CAN at 33.33. We've got that on a board now. And that brings me to our other product. I don't have it sitting out here. I should have brought it out. I'll put an image of it up here. And that is, we've done a special version just for the Tesla Model S. And it's in the store now at $295. And I've chased down the connector for the Tesla. The Tesla has an OBD2 connector. By the way, none of the CAN buses you're going to be interested in are on it.
Correct.
They're on a little diagnostics port under the center console.
Yeah.
And we've chased down, made a little harness for this connector, and just snaps in and hooks up to your laptop. And Colin has been hard at work on a program called SavvyCAN. The real tools the pros use for controller area network in the automotive world, and all of them use the same one, and there, by the way, isn't a second one to use, is from a company called Vector, and the base program is called CANOE,
mm-hmm.
like C-A-N-O-E, a play on a boat, I guess, and CAN.
Correct.
The base model starts at $5,000, and you can't really do anything with it. You got to have modules to plug into it. You're at $12,000 pretty quick.
Uh-huh.
And why do they charge so much? Because there's about nine guys in the world that would know what to do with it.
They're pretty much the only guy in town.
Right. They're the only supplier, and they only have a few customers that are basically OEM car guys.
Yeah.
So it's sort of a closed world. Well, now we're kind of getting into this. We need more professional tools, too. And so we're kind of shooting at the 60, 70% of the Vector tools that you actually use the most or would need, but like at $500 or $700 or something like that.
Yeah. You might find them calling us, too.
And so Colin and I, he's doing the coding. I'm doing the debugging and suggesting other new features.
As you're good at.
As I'm good at.
Mr. Scope Creep.
Has developed this program in an environment called Qt that I'm convinced is truly cross-platform. It's he's working in Windows. I'm proofing it in Mac OS X.
Right.
And Damien's using it in Linux. But it's a little program you run on your laptop and actually capture but also analyze these data. And this week he added DBC files, which is the kind of files that Vector invented to carry the definitions of what each of the bytes and so forth in the CAN stream do and how they relate to the real world.
What they mean, yeah.
And with that file, you can then on screen interpret these messages very easily, and he's got that mostly in SavvyCAN already this week.
That's great.
Let's take a look at what Colin's actually going to walk you through how to do it. This is going to be intensely boring for some people and not for others, because this is a groundbreaking application. The low end of CAN is usually here's the frames.
Yeah.
And here's a little device that can capture them up to 200 or 300 frames a minute. And there you go.
What you do with it is up to you. Yeah.
Have a party. I measured ours at 2,800 frames per minute, per second.
Per second, yeah.
This morning. So Colin's going to give you a little tutorial on how to use it at all.
Hello, EVTV viewers. This is Colin Kidder. I'd like to go over the SavvyCAN program that I have written to help explain how it works a little bit better. Right now on the screen here, I have the SavvyCAN program open, as well as Kvasser CAN King, so that I can show some traffic. So if you're just starting using the program here, I'm not covering how to set up GVRET on a CAN DUI board, but that would be the first step, I suppose. Once you have a GVRET board set up, it will show up as a COM port for whatever kind of operating system you have. In Windows, it's a COM port. In Mac OS X and Linux, it will show up as some form of UART port off of the USB port. But in here, we have COM 8. Say connect to GVRET. You can see that the bus speeds automatically fill in. I have both set to 500 kilohertz for the bus speed. Down here it says that it's connected and shows the firmware version of GVRET. It's 3.16, which is the most recent one. Also down here in the status bar, you can see that I have no files loaded for frame capture and no DBC database loaded. So up here, you could set the CAN bus speeds and then click set CAN bus speeds to set them. You can see the total number of frames I have captured and the frames per second. Suspend capturing would allow me to stop capturing frames. And clear frames clears this list out. So I'll go over here and start up some frame sending. You can see that the total frames captured is going up. Frames per second is about 39, which is pretty accurate probably, because we're at 25 millisecond frame sending, so that should be 40 frames per second. I'll demonstrate here suspend capture. You can see that the total frames captured stops and the frames per second ticks back down to zero. You can restart the frame capture. Clear frames here to redo that. In the frame list, you can see timestamp. This is in microseconds since the board started up, so that's thousandths of a millisecond, milliseconds, and 727 should be the number of seconds that it has been up so far. So then we have over here the ID. Is in hexadecimal, so while 333 might look like it's decimal, you can see down here 64F. These are hexadecimal IDs coming in. I'll stop the frame capture. This would either be 0 for extended frames or 1 for, or excuse me, 0 for standard frames, 1 for extended. The bus would be 1 or 0. You can see that I have the Kvasser is on the second CAN bus, so that's bus 1. The length of the data packet for this frame, and then the data bytes, which are also in hexadecimal. So that is the frame view. If I had started this back up sending frames and clicked auto scroll window, you can see that it stays pretty close to the bottom of the form. It updates only 4 times per second, so it really doesn't have too bad CPU load while doing that. All the forms in this program are freely resizable, so if I wanted to, I could drag this down to see more frames at once. I'll show you interpret frames in a moment. Overwrite mode doesn't currently work. Let me get rid of Kvasser Can King here because I'm done with that. Or I can see I accidentally maximized that form, but doesn't really matter much. So I'm going to clear out the frames, uncheck auto scroll window, and show you how DBC mode works. Go up, excuse me, go up here to File, Load DBC File, in Downloads I have, see, this is a Think City Car full signal database, and you can see down here it now says that a 306 vehicle CAN signal database has been loaded. Go up here to Load a Log File. Down here, CAN captures. Go to bus master logs, which is where I have it captured. Here's a bus master log from a Think City. And here we are with data from a Think City car. There are 69,000 frames. And it might be kind of difficult ordinarily to figure out what do all these things mean. Well, I loaded the DBC file, so we can now actually interpret them. I'll click down here, Interpret Frames. And you can now see that some text showed up here. If I scroll this window bigger, you can see some of the text here. Right now, the PTC electrical power shows as 0 kilowatts and all kinds of things. But that's not a very convenient view. The idea here is if you would like to know what all of the data bytes that are set up in the DBC file mean, you can click on the frame. See, clicking there, it expands, and now I can see all of the various signals that were set up in the DBC file. There isn't really a whole lot of anything interesting in this one, so I can click again and minimize that. Go here. You kind of see a very low number here for the right and left front and rear wheels. That pretty much is zero. There's kind of a rounding error because of the way that's stored in the database there. But if I were to scroll down a bit, now you can see that it does really show up as kilometers per hour. Each wheel is reporting just a little bit different. I don't know if I was turning at the time, but that shows all four wheels. See here, pass status, okay. I don't remember what that means. Don't really know what a whole lot of that is either. But that's how a DBC file works right now in this program. You can left click on and off the various frames to see what the DBC file interprets all these signals as. Here we can see the condenser fan PWM high is 15 milliseconds, so apparently looks like air conditioning. The air conditioning must have been on at this point. The air conditioner is running 3840 RPMs using 1.5 kilowatts. AC pressure 14 bar, so that gives you some status on the air conditioning, and luckily basically everything in the car was specified in this DBC file. I can look in here, VCU stored errors, you can see there's really no errors present. So that's a good way, if you have the DBC file, it's nice to be able to use that to interpret your data. Now, eventually you'll be able to edit DBC files in this program. Currently you cannot, but I can still go in there and kind of show you how it will look. This is the initial screen showing the various ECUs and nodes on the CAN bus. They've got quite a few of them specified in the Think City data here. You can see the PAS actually meant electro-hydraulic power-assisted steering, so when I didn't know what that was before, that's what it is. And these are all the nodes. Now, currently, it has selected vector XXX, which is just a default node if nothing else was set. And down here, we can see every message that was sent by vector XXX, which just means that nobody bothered to set which node sends these frames here, these CCP frames. But if I were to say click on TPMS for the tire pressure, you can see that the tire pressure node sends these four IDs, 344, 345, 782, and 346. And these numbers are in hexadecimal. You can see up here on the VCU, it sends these messages, and there you actually find some that are in hexadecimal. Now, let's say that I'm interested in VCU status. What signals does it have? Well, we can see that the data length is 8, and there are 6 signals. If I click on the 6 signals, it will bring up the signal editor, and I can see what 6 signals are inside that data frame. We have TPMS button learn activation, and VCU software version year, version day, month, PTC ready. Now, you might have noticed when I clicked on these, not only did the name update, but this data grid down here updated. What this shows you is what bits are in this particular signal. So the VCU software year takes up all of the bits in byte 1, which is the second byte. Now that data is all essentially here. Start bit, you can't see it right now, but it would be that one. Bit length of 8 means that it filled in 8 positions. It is in little endian, though that doesn't matter for an 8-bit length. It is an integer. There's scale, bias, min, max values. They're all pretty standard. If I clicked on here, VCU PTC ready, you can see that that has only this one bit set, a bit length of 1. So this is the bit that's used to signal PTC ready. Click out of this and go to any of the other ones that I want. Maybe I'd like to go to the motor controller here. We'll go to PCU torque, which is message 202. And apparently it will crash. Well, that's what we get for pre-production software. So, just had the program crash. I'm going to load another file up here. CAN captures. Let's load a big file that Jack had captured from the Tesla Model S. I'll resize this form a bit and show you another screen here. Go to frame data analysis on this screen, which I'll resize a little bit here. Pretty much every screen's resizable. You have all the frame IDs that were seen on the powertrain bus. I'll start with the one that it defaults on, 000E. Click here. You can see that there were 12,579 frames with that ID. They always have a data length of 8. They come in about 10 milliseconds apart, or 10,000 microseconds. Here on data byte, we could get a histogram of the values that this data byte has traverse through over this range of frames. It has ranged from 15 to 48 at various times. Clicking on the histogram, we can see which values it took and how many times. So, for instance, value 31 or 1F in hex happened 5,100 times. A lot of other values didn't happen quite so often. 46 or 2E only happened 22 times. But we can use this screen, especially, you probably only really need to know the data range normally. You can use that to see if the data byte even did anything. If you click here, we can see it ranged from 0 to 255. And it was fairly even, not perfectly, but quite a few numbers were pretty common there. So there's something going on in that data byte. This one was always 63. That's probably not real interesting. I was always 255, always 8, always 255. That one does change. This one changes. So probably we'd only really want to focus on data bytes that change. New addition right in this version of the program, 109, is the bit field histogram. This one shows you all 64 bits possible in the message and how many times that bit was set. So we can see that bit 6 and 7 of byte 0 were never set, but the rest of these bits were set a fair amount of the time. There were only 12,000 frames, so bits that were set for 8,000 frames are almost always set. You can see through here on the list, these bits were always set, and we kind of did see that on some of those bits that they would be set forever. For instance, this one that always was 255, all the bits were set all of the time. On bit 6, we can see that these first four were always 0, and the next ones normally were set about half the time. So these two histogram views can kind of be used to figure out what the data was doing while the car was going, while the frame capture was commencing. So we can kind of use that to look for interesting data amongst the forest of data that we have. So there's that screen. Flow view can kind of be used to see how the data moved over time, whereas the previous screen just showed the number of times that something happened. With flow view, we can kind of see how that worked out as time progressed. We'll start with 000E like we did before. You can see all of these, this graph has 8 data bytes graphed on it with these various colors. The bits that were set in the message automatically set here as the auto reference for the The reference starts out being equal to the data bytes that were in the first frame. Or if you set auto reference, the reference will automatically update to the previous frame that you viewed, so you can then see as time goes on how things change. Now the grid up here has black bits when the bits have not changed since the previous frame. I'll click here. You can see now the second frame has green and red. Green bits in here are bits that are freshly set in this frame, and red bits are bits that are freshly unset in this frame. So this shows you what happened between the two frames. If I click forward, you can see now, since I don't have auto reference set, we're always getting what changed since the first frame. If I clicked auto reference, now I'm getting what bits changed since the previous frame. These could be used to, say, look for counters that continuously count through the bits. Or if we were looking for a shifter selector or door lock signal, we could look through here to see if a bit gets set and unset as we play around with controls in the car. The playback control here has 6 buttons. This one means go back one frame. Stop will bring you back to 0 on the current frame. This is forward one, or if you accidentally double click, forward 2. This plays backwards. You can see it it zipped backwards. The playback speed here is in milliseconds, so it zipped back one frame every 25 milliseconds. If I click forward, now we're going forward every 25 milliseconds. We're going forward one frame, and you can see frame data just flying by there. I'll set this to 250 to make it a little easier to see. And now that's flying by a lot less quickly. See the data bytes here? I still have auto reference set, so it's showing me the difference between each successive frame. And this is showing me this plus is the frame that we're currently on. So you can see behind it and ahead of it to see what the data we're doing in the past and in the future. But this is the current time position of this frame here. So you can see this purple seems to be jumping up and down a lot. Purple, or that's dark magenta apparently, it's byte 7. So byte 7 has quite a bit of activity. We can look at byte 6 cyan here. That's looks to be forming some form of counter, just continually stepping up, 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 dropping down, stepping up, up, up. So this lets us see what things are doing over time. I'll stop this here with pause. Real-time capture, that's a lie, it doesn't do anything. Graph by timestamp, if I click that and then click a different frame, let's say I want to graph 204, or 212, sorry. Now the axis here is in the timestamps from here, so these are in microseconds. Now you can see this graphed in microseconds. So when something happens, we can look at the transition and find out the time span that it took for that transition to happen. It may not be terribly handy to be able to see that here, but sometimes that's handy to be able to correlate this with time on a clock, you might say. So that's the frame, the flow view screen. Real quick, I'll show you playback screen. This has the same playback controls as the flow view screen. Playback speed here, it actually even tells you it's in milliseconds. On this screen, the milliseconds can be set all of the way down to zero. In that case, it will just try to spit frames out as quickly as it can. Send to CAN bus, we can send the frames out on CAN bus 1 or 0 or both at the same time. Or from file, which may be handy, if you select from file, it will go over here and pick the bus that the frame originally came in on and send it back out that bus. So, for instance, you could capture two buses at once and then play them back on both buses at once with the correct frames playing back onto the correct buses. Down here we have ID filtering. We can use this. Let's say I do not want to send frame 0102. Then I can select that, and those frames will not be sent as we're ticking through the list. You can deselect them all, select just one, select them all. I believe that Jack and Mark had showed on a previous video how they had used this capability to narrow down which messages were necessary for the heater that I'll probably butcher, the Ebbesbacher. So that's how they would do it. What you would do is deselect frames while playing. Say we're playing through here and then deselect frames, and look at the device that you're hoping to control and wait until that device faults or quits working. And when it faults, let's say it faults when I deselect 0168, then I know that it must be looking at that frame, and so I want to keep that frame checked. I can start deselecting others. After doing that through the whole list, you can find out which messages a particular device on the CAN bus is looking for and which messages it doesn't care about. Get a better idea of what is necessary to control that device. So that's what you would use playback for. The last screen I want to show right now, because most of the rest of these things don't work. Single multi-state isn't functional yet. Range state doesn't work. Fuzzy scope. The next one I want to show is graph data, which I'll probably want to make a little bigger view. This starts off kind of plain, but if you right-click, you can add a new graph. Let's graph, we'll go with 0xE here, the frame that we've been looking at most of the time. I'll graph data byte 0. You can leave all these blank if you don't know what they do or don't really care. If we wanted to treat this value as signed, we could. If we wanted to set a mask, we could. Otherwise, it defaults to no mask. Well, you can use a mask to mask off certain bits from this data byte or series of bytes, which I'll show in a moment, in case maybe you have a value that spans two bytes but does not span all of the bits within them. Bias can be used to move the graph up and down to compensate. Scale, once again, can be used to scale the graph up and down in the y-axis. Stride is used, probably not very often, but you can use stride to pick up only every x number of data points. Let's say I thought that there were just too many messages from 0xE and I didn't want to plot them all. I could say put stride in as 10 and it would plot only every 10th data point and make the graph a little less busy. But ordinarily, that's not much of a problem. Stride defaults to 1. Color is automatically a random color every time you go to set up a new graph, or we can change it to anything we want. I'll set this one to, well, we'll set it to red. So I'll add that graph, and you can see the graph shows up here. If I click on the graph and use my scroll wheel, I can scroll in and out on it. But better, if I click down here on the time axis edge of the graph here in these numbers, now my scroll wheel scrolls in only that axis, and if I left click and drag around, it drags in only that axis. You can see moving up and down doesn't do a thing. Likewise here, now the scroll wheel sets the scaling this way for the graph, and the mouse only moves up and down. If I left click back on the graph, now I'm in free mode again, and I can see that that works out. Let's see what happens if I add a new graph. The ID, pretty much all the stuff on this form can use anything you want. You can put things in binary if you want. I think you have to prefix it with B if you use binary. I don't know why you would want to use binary for the ID, but maybe you might for the mask. But because you can use binary, hexadecimal, or decimal, 0xE is 14. I can set that to 14. Let's graph data byte 1 now. We'll leave it at purple. And you can see that that data byte is really, really noisy. It seems to be a much larger scale than the first one that we graphed, and that makes it kind of difficult for me to see what's going on. So let's take this graph and scale it up to 10 and see if that makes that any better. It's kind of hard here. Let's scroll through, move my time axis out and see what these two are doing. Now I can see them a little better. And you can see that this graph that I brought in here with data byte 1 seems to be very choppy. It seems to count down, up, very abrupt. Not really sure. You might not be sure at this point why it's doing that, but you might have seen over here, ordinarily when there's an abrupt transition on this byte, there is a transition on this byte as well. You can see stair step. Pretty much every time this data byte has a disjunction, this data byte has a step. We might take that as a sign that these two bytes are correlated in some way. And in fact, I know they are. So if we go in here to make a new graph and say 0 to 1, to graph those two bytes as a 16-bit integer. Now we'll see up there that those two bytes combined form this signal. I don't really need these anymore. They really aren't separate signals. They combine to form this signal, which I'll stretch the time axis out on a bit, stretch the scaling a bit. Now I'll select this one so I can go back and forth. And we can see that this seems to form a reasonably smooth graph. Now I don't know what this is. The file that we have loaded here was drive around circle. So my guess is, and I don't have any proof of this, my guess is that this data might be steering wheel position of some sort. That maybe he was driving along, steered one way, steered the other way, steered back up, came back down. Another thing that we can do, I mentioned that you can use bias. I could zoom way in on this line that seems to get straight and see that it goes to 8096. That's an awfully convenient value. So what I might do is go in here and say edit selected graph, bias this down 8096. And now you can see that it is more centered on the zero axis, the zero point here. So presumably, whatever this is the baseline, and this went above the baseline, below the baseline, above, below. So I don't know if it is steering data, then that might be straight ahead, and these are turns. Not really sure. We would have to get in a car and do more analysis, maybe crank the wheel one way than the other, and bring up the data to make sure that it is what I think it is. And if that data is steering position sensor, or the steering position, then we can start forming a DBC file, as I showed earlier. DBC editing doesn't work yet, but when it does, then perhaps if we knew what this was, we could go into a DBC file, set up the message and signal to show that this is steering position, and from then on we'll know what the steering position is. Another thing that I could do, show you real quickly, we can look here and I can see that this went up to a little less than 4,340 at the top end here, and it went down not quite to 4,200. So it seems to have as much forward range above and below the axis. Now, I don't know what that scaling means, but once again, we could kind of experiment with that and then guess at scaling. If we knew how far the steering wheel turned, we might guess that, say, 4,600 or 4,500 is the maximum turn on the steering wheel. Maybe that's degrees, and this is in hundredths of a degree turning on the steering wheel. I could be way off on that guess, but in reverse engineering, it's kind of necessary a lot of times to take educated guesses and then try to prove yourself right or wrong. So that's the graphing view. I believe that pretty much completes everything. There are this custom frame sender thing will be hooked up soon. That's another thing coming for a future video. Probably complete the single and multi-state soon. Edit messages. Well, that's it for this video. Thank you for watching.
As our world grows, it's necessary to invest in sustainable transportation to reduce our impact on the planet and ultimately create economic efficiencies wherever possible. Electric vehicles are becoming the leaders of this efficient, sustainable movement. In electric vehicles, the driver experience is just as important as the batteries that power it. EVs display different information than conventional vehicles, such as the amount of energy stored, expected mileage on a current charge, and distance until empty. Monitoring vehicle efficiency and energy consumption are more critical than ever because of driving range limitations experienced in EVs that are different than your conventional vehicles. This presents new challenges to structure and simplify new driver information for operating EVs. Andromeda Interface's EVIC was designed to collect, interpret, and consolidate data onto one vehicle dashboard to provide a reliable and configurable device to monitor the operation and safety of your electric vehicle. From monitoring your motor controllers to your battery management systems, EVIC is a human-machine interface that seamlessly interprets all the complex data coming from these devices. EVIC presents the driver information in one simple display unit. And we are continuing to build our portfolio of certified interfaces from other EV suppliers. Please review our list of supported EV components on our website. Andromeda Interfaces is striving to enable human-machine technology that helps improve the safety and efficiency of electric vehicles. By doing this in a cost-effective way, we are helping to accelerate the growth of sustainable transportation.
Okay, so that was Colin Kidder.
Good job, Colin.
And I'm very excited about this program. Again, we're going to have a Tesla-specific product, which is not recommended for everybody. It's if you have a Tesla and want to do, we're going to make it easy. More generally, is a product half its price, the Candui 2, and that's the Teodora. This isn't really a good time. I've got a few of them left if you have to have them, but I got the better one, the dual can with the SavvyCAN, about 4 weeks out.
Yeah.
And I should have those. And then we're going to have this if you just want to play, but this is really the heart of our controllers for the chargers and so forth. Just a little single can Dewey board. But we'll make that available at $99 or something. No, I'm not giving them away at Arduino prices. Go buy an Arduino.
Yeah.
The we are going to have the Hack Team secret meeting in the fort with no girls.
The He-Man Woman Haters Club.
The He-Man Woman Haters Club. Hack Team secret meeting.
Secret.
And Byron Isbenhard has called this meeting. It's not really my meeting. And he wants to get together and do some stuff. But Colin's coming down. Damien has threatened repeatedly to come.
Oh, is that right?
Assures us he's not coming. Which probably means he's coming.
Watch him surprise us, huh?
I don't know. We'll see.
Well, I'm looking forward to meeting all the guys.
Yeah, and we're going to have several of them here. Rich Morris in Madison with the Studebaker has joined the Hack Team, and he's coming.
Oh, good.
And so we're going to have a meeting June 12th through the 14th. I'm advised by Byron that I'm hosting that then.
Yeah.
And
to have plenty of beer on hand.
And we're going to probably play with the Tesla test bench and maybe one of the smart cars a little bit. And we're going to kind of have a meeting and talk about what's happened over and over is I've set targets that with a 8 or 12 month plan, and 6 weeks later, it's over. We got it going. So I need a little help envisioning, what prioritizing our targets of opportunity.
Yeah.
And then probably do the usual thing, get liquored up and play with some high voltage and go for a drive.
Find some place to shoot guns too, right?
Show me what you've been doing to help me get the test bench ready for the secret Hack Team meeting.
Let's do it.
Hey. Mom, we've been hard at work on the bench. What do we got going here? Normally, I like to wire up a test bench quick and dirty because it's just temporary, right?
Yep.
Except we've got benches that have been in here 2 years. And about half the time my testing is spent fixing the wiring that I never did do right in the first place because it's just a temporary test bench, right?
Right, right.
We have the Hack Team coming the 12th of June through the 14th, and the numbers are growing. And I would like for them to show me how to make this thing spin.
That's our whole goal.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're out for.
So I figure the better job we get done putting this together, the better off we'll be.
Well, it is kind of our crown jewel of test benches.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and we
Tesla drivetrain's a big deal.
Absolutely.
And we're getting a lot of response from people curious about it and following the progress. So let's revisit what we have going on here. What did you do this week?
Well, as you know, Charlie had already mounted the motor and such, and what we've done is installed the cooling system and plumbed that all up.
Mm-hmm.
We installed the charger and got the plumbing set up for that. We're just about, well, and then we've got the control panel here, so we're ready to get that wired up.
Okay. And, so the cooling system, this is a liquid-cooled motor.
That's correct.
And it looks like the motor more than the inverter. It kind of goes in one end and comes out here at the bottom of the thing. So we have a tank here, a little higher than our motor.
So we can get the air bubbles out.
Mm-hmm. And our Pierberg pump down here. I had several questions this week about the wiring of that from some other people. Stan Cloyd, one of our viewers, has actually done a little video on that. I think we aired it in one episode. It's a pulse width modulated pump that you can control, except we never do. We just fire that mother up and let her go full bore. It does about 20 liters a minute. But my theory is the quicker you move it through, the better things
go. Full blast.
And so we wire the pump PWM to the 12 volt and the ground to the ground, and it just runs on.
Zings along.
You've got us a switch here for the pump, and the pump's kind of our lowest thing. Well, I guess not. I guess the charger's the lowest thing.
Oh, good point.
And so we go down to the pump, and then where?
Then out the pump, or out the pump to the charger, and
okay.
then up through the charger to the motor,
mm-hmm.
out the motor to the radiator, and then back.
And then back into our tank. And so that works for me. We get our drop through the radiator, the heat exchanger, and then a little extra cooling in the tank before we go back to my poor pump.
Yeah.
And the charger, I was kind of anti-liquid chargers at first, but they are smaller and more durable. I like this volt charger.
It does put out some heat.
The idea being you just put it in your regular loop, because when you're driving, you're probably not charging.
Correct.
So it's going to be extra heat sink.
Right.
And when you're charging, you're probably not driving. So this would be an extra heat sink. So we've got it all in one loop. Now, this particular Durali had a some sort of a thermostat on it. Well, how's that work?
Well, you know, the temperature is a mystery to me. I don't know exactly what temperature triggers
it. At
some temperature, it will trigger the fan.
Okay, so we run the power through this thermostatic switch to the fan.
12 volt, yeah.
So it comes on automatically when it reaches some temperature.
Correct.
We would turn the pump on and power them both with this switch, and the pump would start immediately. The fan
comes on
at random, usually right when we're starting to film something, probably.
Right.
And it'll be loud.
It'll be a noisy one.
Good. And so that's our cooling system. And instead of my messy cart, we just rigged it up. We're kind of like building a car here on this maple bench.
Yeah.
And by the time we get done, we'll have a car here.
Yeah.
With no wheels.
We'll have a battery right where you're standing.
I'm standing on the battery, and and we've got our power cables here going to two big power bars.
Yeah. I'm not touching you.
No, there's no battery hooked up to it yet. And you do have some covers for these, don't you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. And we'll cover those, but our charger will be wired into this and our battery pack. And although the battery pack's going to go through, you're going to have a couple contactors here, aren't you?
That's right. Yeah, we still have to wire up the other miscellaneous electronics.
Okay, so it's two contactors, and that'll give us a precharge and a high voltage. The precharge will turn on our negative contactor, and the positive contactor will have a pre-charged resistor across the terminals. So we turn on the negative contactor, that completes the circuit. That'll fill up the caps in the charger and the inverter. And then we hit the positive, that bypasses the resistor and we're hooked up. And so that's what that is.
Yep.
You've got a 12-volt fuse panel down here.
Mm-hmm.
This crank switch, how's this going to work?
So that will be connected to the 12 volts directly, and then once
or it, battery.
Well, and through the high volt as well.
Mm-hmm.
But once, if we kill this, then that cuts out all the 12 volts, and obviously the high volt as well.
So that cuts off the 12 volts from the battery to the fuse block, and then all these get fed on the fuses, right?
That's right.
Okay. So that'll release our two high-voltage contactors.
Whether they're on or not.
Our pump, everything else.
Shut down.
All right. This is, we kind of have a peculiar situation here. I guess we'll use one of these. These are two ways, but I need one to switch 12 volts here to my connector for the inverter. This one is, this button is just a momentary contact. That's going to be our brake. The Tesla drivetrain has a lot of different modes electronically, but almost all of them, you can't put them in that mode without stepping on the brake.
Right.
And how that works is your brake switch in your car runs a relay, and out the normally closed contacts, you get 12 volts. And out of the normally open contacts, you get nothing. And both of those are wired in to this connector. When you press the brake, the normally closed opens, and that goes to nothing. And the normally open closes, and 12 volts there. So it's actually a two-signal, a very positive check, that you've got the brake engaged. And I think what we're going to find is when we send it mode signals over CAN, like forward or I guess drive, reverse, neutral, park, parking brake on, etc., that if that brake signal isn't right on both pins, it's going to ignore the hell out of that CAN.
I believe that.
And we never go into drive. If our test bench is going to work anything like our Model S over there. And so we've rigged up a button with a relay on the back that when you press the button, it'll ground the relay and it will switch those two lines and we'll wire those right into there.
Right.
I've had meager success locating the plug on our encoder end.
Mm.
What are we gonna do about hooking up to that?
That's a good question, but if we can't find the connector, then we will just make, take some connector pins and heat
put some heat shrink on them
and plug them in individually.
I guess so.
And just, you know, we're going to hot wire it.
That'll be the best we can. That again goes in on four wires on our 23-pin amp seal, Tyco. And so that's, we've got to wire that up. We've already got the throttle, which again turned out to be a Ford Fusion throttle. And I thought it looked a lot different than the Tesla. I even found a guy selling the brake pads for Fords that look like the Tesla brake pads.
Oh, the covers?
Silver, yeah. One, it's just covers.
Dress up, yeah.
Yeah, that's just dressing. Mm-hmm. There's nothing special about it. They're on eBay if you want your car to have Model S pedals. Yeah. So we'll have our six input wires for our two analog inputs from the throttle into here. What have we got yet to go? We've got a charger, and you're going to add a battery.
We are going to add a battery.
I guess I got to come up with a charge controller.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll make one of those.
Yep, and then the other miscellaneous, like you said, contactors and the pre-charger.
The contactors.
Sister. Yeah.
Yeah, and those will go underneath here.
We'll mount that under the bench there somewhere.
So, yeah, let's put the battery here where it's kind of difficult to get up here and get your hip into both hot bars.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I put those far apart so your tongue can't touch both.
Well, you know, we a lot of these events, we kind of have a tendency to get liquored up, play with some high voltage, maybe go for a drive. So we need to guard against somebody falling into there. I figure put the battery pack here where they really got to stumble hard to get to it.
It'll probably be the battery that gets them before that.
Well, the battery kind of fall into, not really get hurt. It's all in cans. But this, you know, we're a little close together here where you could get a body across both of them. But that's how much bench I got to work with. I love what you've done here. But let's put some covers on them.
Yeah.
Put the battery in front of it.
Yeah,
we've and got so if we get a little bit much into Jack's whiskey, we're probably not going to get across that.
Yeah.
And so that'll work out pretty well. I love the way you've angled the panel and got it all screwed in. This looks very professional.
Mm-hmm. It's not my first rodeo.
Well,
but it's, you know, there's always room for improvement. It's
I think it's worth putting the effort in. I've done that OEM, just random components bench 3 times, and half of the things I was struggling with was my own dicked up wiring rat's nest there, and so the better we get that bench.
Which brings up another point. We'll probably want to document this so that we can
figure out what we wired
what
up.
What we did, you know, a year from now.
Yeah, we can do that. Yeah, we'll document it. The Tesla is going to be kind of a big deal for us. The other thing we're right in the throes of on the in the hack team. Discussion is they already think this is done. I'm not so sure. If we do get it done, what would we... I don't think this is ever coming off here.
This particular one, no. This is the tester.
I've built the Siemens bench, the UQM bench. They're kind of permanent fixtures. And the reason is, eventually... we're going to have to do something either with a JevQ or a new device or perhaps a touchscreen device that takes the modes that we have in the Model S and converts them to these CAN bus signals. Good. See, the JevQ is designed to actually drive the inverter with CAN bus signals. Our inverter drives with the brake and accelerator.
Right there, hardwired. But
we've got all these modes, and they have to be CAN bus signals. And the switchology starts to get to be kind of a mess. Devising that, like a gear shift that does that, is non-trivial. So I'm thinking a touchscreen panel, that's sort of Tesla-esque.
That's a good call.
And that you press a thing on the screen and then it starts spewing that CAN bus signal. Because you're in that mode.
That's perfect.
And so that will be our, if I can get decoded these modes out of the Model S, which is getting easier. We now offer on the website, actually, I located the connectors for the diagnostics connector under the center console and took a CAN DUI and made a little enclosure and so forth with a wiring harness where it's real easy to click that into that connector and capture.
USB to the laptop?
Right, to the laptop. And Colin has done some fantastic progress on this SavvyCAN program.
Right.
And we've been kind of going back and forth on, you know, as soon as you add a function, then you can see what would be really be neat if you could only do this. And so there's been a lot of that. But we have in the store now $295, but it's got the connector and the harness, and you just plug it into your Model S, and you can capture two body buses, one chassis bus, and the powertrain bus are all on that connector, and a K-line LIN bus. Which I'm not, it's for windows and doors and shit or something.
Okay.
Which you're not going to need. But Anyway, we'll have it with the connector, bunch of pins. I'll wire it up for the powertrain, but you can wire it up for any of the buses you want to. And so that will work. And his SavvyCAN program is turning into a quite a device. And he's developed it in Qt, which is kind of a cross-platform thing. We've always looked for one of those, but none of them ever work. Except I'm working great on the Mac, and he's hardly ever been on a Mac and hates Apple products.
Right.
So we may have the first cross-platform development system that actually works.
It works on Windows.
He does it on Windows, and it's working on my Mac.
Right, right.
And it's working pretty good.
Glorious.
And then where it's not working, it was like, uh-oh, yeah, we forgot that part. You know, or some design change. And so development on that continues. And it's a matter of sousing it out. But we're going to have to come up with something probably a little bit different than JevQ. Probably some sort of touchscreen Arduino thing with the CanDUI on it where we can, like, touch a button on the screen and make the proper CAN codes come out.
Right, right.
Like it changes the park message and turns on the reverse message or something.
Right.
And that's what this will get. And again, you have to have the brake on. In a car, that's not going to be a problem. We can wire a relay into your brake switch. It's
sure.
easy.
Maybe even tap off of it if there's a
right.
You know, a micro switch on the brake pedal.
Well, see, we need these two wires. There is a micro switch on the brake pedal. We'll tap off of that and have it energize a relay that swaps the two lines.
Does both, yeah.
And goes right into here. That'll work great. But how do we select low regen or standard? Which you know has to be done in the inverter.
Mm-hmm.
Or range mode or normal mode.
Or insane.
Or insane mode. they even have a separate parking brake. Even though if you put it in park, it apparently holds. I think there's something further with this parking brake. And so there's a traction control. Now, the way that's stated is it's probably something in here.
Okay.
And so we're going to have to decode all those CAN messages. But then you're going to have to be able to send them. That's no problem. But what's the manual input? How do you select that?
That's
75 toggle switches?
Seen, you know?
75 toggle switches? Or you see what I mean?
We got room for a couple more. You know?
Oh, right. No, you're going to run out of panel here at some point.
It's going to look like an old World War II cockpit, you know?
Uh-huh. And so I actually got coming a version of Dewey that we're doing for EVTV that's a EVTV Dewey with one CAN port on it. That you don't need the Dewey CAN to do one bus and has a stronger USB port on it and an EEPROM chip. And struggle to get that done and working.
Yep.
From the various Chinese suppliers. Yep. But I'm homing in on it. My latest one got two out of five sample boards working.
Yeah, we got a couple.
So the concept works. I just have to find somebody that can actually put them together. We could take that and put some sort of a touchscreen thing on top of it and make a little panel you could put in your dash to select the various Tesla modes to drive the drivetrain. And so that's going to be a further challenge. This is a non-trivial project, but they are essentially the pinnacle of electric vehicle technology, and we want to do that.
Exciting.
And that's brought up the topic of what the hell do we put it in. And I'm really lost on that one. Of course, I got too many cars. I don't want to. The easiest thing to put it in would be my Model S. But it already has one. What was your vote?
The Factory 5 GTM was my.
And why do you like that one?
Because it's got the Corvette running gear in it, which already has independent rear end, so we can just adapt these axles to the control arms on the outside of the Factory 5 car. And plus, you know, this is going to be our crown jewel of electric conversions, so I think that it's got to be something what we call bitchin'.
Now, does the Factory 5 use the whole Corvette chassis or just the wheel parts off of it?
It's Factory 5's engineered chassis, which I think we could even work with to get battery location in boxes and actually come up with a really good balance. But it's their own tubular frame, but it's Corvette running gear.
Is it independent rear suspension?
Corvettes are all independent rear end.
Are they?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's the beautiful thing of it. It's just a matter of engineering some mounting points for this guy and stuff it up in there and.
It's an idea.
I think it's a beautiful thing.
It has
your thoughts are welcome as well.
You bet. It's what do we do to if we get this working? What do we do to demonstrate that?
Right. And let's cross that bridge when we
kind of has to. No, it kind of has to be something special.
Yeah.
Here's why I'm excited about the hack team, and them coming in the 12th to the 14th. I set these projects up for a 4 to 6 or 8 month development. Man, everything we've turned our attention to has fallen in days or weeks.
Lightning.
When you've got people spread across the globe with different talents, you know, one guy's a math whiz and one guy's a C++ whiz and one guy designed circuit boards and one guy is just good at wiring up stuff and testing things and you put all those guys together.
It's a good thing.
It's kind of surprising.
Yeah, it's really exciting.
It's kind of exciting because
why I'm standing here.
It feels like I'm having lots of great thoughts and ideas. I'm getting them because they keep sending them to me by email. Right. That's where they come from. So it's kind of a group mind thing that John Hardy calls the wisdom of crowds.
I've
seen the worst of that, which is DIY electric, where everybody makes up shit and then everybody else elaborates on it, and none of it really works that way.
Right.
And now this is the other end, the productive end of it, where stuff actually happens, and it's very exciting. I have better ideas when Colin's actually making shit like that happen the next day.
Yeah.
And he has better ideas to make it happen because I had better ideas.
Right.
And so there's kind of a cross stimulation that goes on that's, whoa, it moves things along pretty quickly. And so this could fall. And then what do we do?
Going down.
Yeah, it's what is going down. It could go down in June. I'm okay if it takes till December. I don't mind. We'll just keep sawing away at it, you know. Some of this stuff is falling pretty quickly. And then I don't really want a huge delay of 2 years until we see it roll.
Of course.
We need to get it in a car. And I got nothing here that really, the Doka would be easy.
But
you're not a big fan of the Doka. I don't know that it's an appropriate use of a Tesla rear end.
It's a great candidate. Don't get me wrong. I really like the concept of where you could put the batteries and slide them in and out. But
who needs a 0 to 60 in 5.5 second Doka?
Right.
You know that.
Yeah.
What's that?
Whose boat does that float?
Yeah. And so, well, the VW guy, but we have done VWs to death.
Yeah.
I mean, we've wrung them out. Pretty
good.
And
this can actually handle a slightly heavier, you know, car. You know, it really opens the options, the possibilities of what we could do. And so, yeah, we really need to make it pretty universal, and so that you can put it in just about anything.
But it needs to be a head turner.
Yeah.
And I don't only need to finance a $150,000 car. I found a delightful ivory 1960 Mercedes 190 SL. It's only $150,000. And of course, it had a original matching numbers engine that was all sparkly.
Somebody would put a contract
what am I going to do with
you
that?
Did something like
and so there you go. So what to put it in is the next issue.
Sure.
But let's get this thing turning a little bit. And so we got to put some ATF. Now, on the coolant, Do you have that right Everlast stuff?
Right behind you.
This is something I got before.
Waterless.
Never really used it. It's called Evans Waterless Engine Coolant. Here's the trick with this. You can't, it doesn't really work very good in a system that's had water in it. You really have to blow it out and dry it all out and everything. This one's never had anything in it.
Good place to start.
And it, if you use real water, it kind of craps up your stuff pretty quick.
Corrosion. Low boiling point.
And antifreeze, when we spill it, it's so slimy.
It stinks.
I hate it.
You can taste it.
Yeah. It gets in your hair from the floor somehow. and so we're going to try this Evans Heavy Duty Coolant. This boils at 375 degrees Fahrenheit.
If we hit that.
So no boiling.
We probably did something wrong.
And yeah. And so, but ideally it's very good at corrosion control too. So an artificial coolant that you might look up is this Evans waterless engine coolant from Pure Coolant. And, I think they're kind of, everything I've read about it and seen on their little video things seems to imply that it's really a good deal. And so that's nothing but the best for the Tesla drivetrain.
Exactly.
And I don't want to run water through it and gunk it up. And if we're going to be hooking things up and disconnect them, I don't want to use antifreeze at all.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of where we're at. This is not really slimy. That's its, one of its major characteristics for me. But it doesn't mix well with water. And so we're going to, all these components are sort of virgin and haven't had any water in them. Before we get them wet, let's go to this and see what we can do.
Although, you know, these are used. Well, they're probably clean.
Well, they're pretty dry by now.
Yeah.
They've been out of car for quite a while.
And if anything, we just, you know, flush it, put another gallon in it,
mm-hmm.
flush it.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think we'll run into a lot of water in there. And so that's what we're going to do with that. So stay with us for more Tesla drivetrain adventures. This is going to be an ongoing project, but we're working furiously to try to get this bench in good order for the arrival of the hack team. Meet in June 12th to the 14th, and part of that is to work on this, and the other is to sort of brainstorm a little bit about our targets of opportunity in the future, and where we ought to aim all that, and the other part is to, get a little liquored up, play with some high voltage, and go for a
little
drive.
Fellowship, and
go for a drive,
camaraderie, and, yeah.
There you go. Stay with us.
So, well, and I'd like to add, along the the lines of what I was saying about the Factory 5 GTM, that mm-hmm. It not only is it going to be a great car, but it also is in the same vein as the with what we do, and that is for the DIY guy. Mm-hmm. It's the build your own car, and so not only would it be ultra fast and powerful, but it's something that a guy gets to build in his own garage.
Uh-huh.
So
it's got some merit. We looked at that a couple of years ago. They're pretty proud of those.
Oh yes.
Those Corvette parts too. Yeah. They don't come in the mail with your.
It's not for everybody.
Yeah. It's, but we'll look at it. I don't know. I want something that's a real head turner that puts a point on this taking of OEM parts and using them for heirloom and classic and cars like the GTM.
That's a whole segment
that you can do yourself. And I want to drive that point home pretty hard. The Tesla drivetrain does that better than any other part. And now I need a car that does that better than any other car.
Yeah.
And I'm frozen in terror. and the problem is, this can go pretty quick. You got that bench pretty far along.
Well.
Everlast coolant and all that.
Yeah.
A slanted control panel like NASA.
We've even made some pretty significant progress in the last day or so. So we're, you know.
Yeah, I think we're going to be ready. They would, if they can figure it out with the SavvyCAN and that.
Boy, that's going to be glorious.
I think that motor can be made to turn.
Even if I hear a click click, I'll be excited.
I would get pretty breathy over a click click. Yeah.
You know.
But no, I at this point I kind of look for this thing to spin up.
Yeah. Well, knock on wood, and let's hopefully it.
If we can do it the smart way, we will. And if we can't, we'll just
keep beating our head against the wall, and we'll.
We'll just take a massive capture and just use SavvyCAN to feed it to the inverter. And
right.
Hopefully, we can hit the brake at the right time.
Yeah.
See, I think the modes and the brake are interactive.
Those. Yeah.
That's my. It's not my fear. That's my. Actually, I'm pretty sure that that's the case.
Quite convinced.
And so you have a mechanical or analog switch that qualifies a CAN signal. And so getting that timed correctly initially will be an issue. But as we work off what specific messages do that and so forth, the actual doing of it isn't going to be so hard. As I said at the bench, I keep getting little projects for myself. I think I'm going to have to do a touch screen with a Dewey that does CAN just to have, it'll be a control box for the Tesla drivetrain because there's more to it than I thought.
It's quite interactive.
The regen, you can change the traction control, you can change the range or standard mode, you can change the parking brake, you can set with a switch on the console. Mm. And then you have park, neutral, drive, and reverse. And so there's some modes and to do this with what? 30 different toggle switches or what? You know, so to make that real in any modern sense, we're going to have to build, as we do, a controller for the Eberspacher, a controller for the charger. The JevQ is really about driving inverters that operate by CAN. The Tesla doesn't. It operates from the pedal.
Hardwired.
But it has CAN modes. And that's not, I mean, JevQ can do that, but it's almost like, then how do you tell the JevQ to do it? And I need buttons on maybe a smartphone interface for the Tesla drivetrain or something where you can push a button on screen and make these mode selections and it send out the necessary CAN messages. Right. Now, coordinating that with the brake is only a problem on our test bench.
Right.
In the car, you have a brake. And, of course, we can make two a normally open and normally closed signal off that brake switch. And you have to put the brake on to change from park to drive. That's pretty natural in the car.
Most cars
it's
are.
It's in the simulation that it's kind of tricky.
Yeah.
But in the car, it's not. Yeah. But we got too many modes. I have to take all those buttons off the Tesla center console and make a device to do that.
Yeah.
And but that could be fun too. There are little screens and some touch screens and stuff you can get for Arduino Deweys. And I'm gonna get, I think Sane Smart makes a little 5-inch or something with a touch screen. And that I can put buttons on, and when you press the button, there's some logic. I mean, when you press park, I think what we'll find is you press park, press park to move it into drive, that it sends a command to the inverter. And the inverter sends the command back to change the light, select the other button.
Okay. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
That's what we're going to find. And then, so some things are mutually exclusive. You can't be in neutral and drive at the same time.
Yeah.
So there's some logic there, but the rest of it's just light the button and send that command out and receive the command to change the button. That could be some decoding. But if you kind of know what's going on and what to look for, it shouldn't be too bad.
Anybody can do it. The hack team can do it.
Well,
right?
But I think it's going to be a challenge. But not in it. It's not going to be a challenge to get the motor turning. It's going to be a challenge to work out all these little lights and buttons.
Yeah, at the right times.
Yeah. And so that could be some interesting work. But we'll get a good start on it. And we've covered the Nordlox EVT Dewey, the Tesla CAN kit. What do you got?
That's a wrap.
Bob, welcome to EVTV.
Thank you so much.
And I hope this fulfills your expectations. I think you're going to be a great addition. He's kind of a computer guy. He's done some car stuff. You've been into cars, right?
I love cars. I've built a couple myself, just ice engines. Forgive me, folks. But
Well, we all
they
start
were quite
somewhere.
Nice anyway.
And you were kind of into the whole IT.
Yeah, I've got a computer background. I've got a networking, mechanical. I'm kind of a jack of all trades, master of one or two.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's kind of how we ride around here.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not a
everything's an opportunity to improve, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's
this is
a pleasure to be here.
Fun. I think we're doing important work. I think the next year we're going to see, as I said, the EV whole concept come under fire, but it's not the end of the world. It's another phase.
Yeah.
And as I have mentioned to you all on several occasions, and sometimes I come across as a wet blanket, they're all ready to pop champagne, declare victory. It's over. We don't even need you, Jack. It's we won.
A little premature.
Yeah, that'd be nice. I've got some plans.
That's why we're here, right?
I've got some plans for making whiskey in my old age, but a few more miles before we sleep, I suspect, guys, things just don't go that easy.
Yeah.
And they're not going to this time either. As I said, we'll have waves of enthusiasm and excitement in the whole media, into doing the EV story. And then we'll have waves of disenchantment and disappointment and
the gloom and doom.
Gloom and doom and the end of the world. And that's just actually what it feels like to be in an emerging technology.
Yeah. And then there'll be a breakthrough.
And then there'll be a number of breakthroughs.
Yeah.
And then right when it's all going bad, somebody will trot out a battery we never even thought of, and it'll get all exciting again. Meanwhile, we're going to keep plugging away and driving electric, and trying to acculturate the population to why it's important and good to drive a car that doesn't make much noise, doesn't put out much fumes. And doesn't get our kids sent to the Middle East to get whacked up, dealing with a bunch of sand bunnies that don't like us anyway while we're trying to mail them money.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of that I don't like. And so we're not going to do it one way or the other. And
doggone it, these things are fun to drive.
And doggone it, meanwhile, aren't they fun to drive?
Yeah.
You drove the white van this week.
I drove the white van. I moved the Escalade.
Found out that takes a little work, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
And we'll get you in the Speedster this week, pretty soon you'll be enough.
We'll try them all.
Yep, you're gonna get to drive them all and try them all. So that's I think it's gonna work out pretty nicely, and so. You guys stay with us, and we'll try to do it again next week. My vacationing for the year, I hope, is over. I did go to Hot Springs.
Yeah.
I met my brothers and sisters, their kids. and their kids' kids. There were no fatalities, and a good time was had by all. And I am certainly glad to be back in the harness again.
Yeah.
It feels good. Stay with us. We'll see you next week.